Our talk this morning is primarily about black country humour. But first of all, I ought to explain, I think, where and what this black country is. It is really a tremendous industrial belt. Some years ago, a commission was set up to define the black country boundaries. They've always been the subject of argument. And they said, Birmingham was not the black country. I said, thank the Lord for that. But they did say, it started in Smerwick, went out through West Bromwich, Darlaston, on through Cowsley, right out to Wolverhampton. And when you got to Wolverhampton, you come down towards Stourbridge, then back up to the Birmingham boundary on the top of Mucklow Hill. So you had, roughly, 28 different towns in the Black Country. Now, it started because hundreds of years ago, we found iron ore at a place called Pensnet. Now, all under the Black Country, there was a lot of coal, which naturally was used to smelt the iron. In places like Dudley, under the caverns, and under the present football ground, there was lime, a purifier or a flux. Then we've got an abundance of sand, which makes the moulds for molten metal, but with the most important mineral of all. That is fire clay, stretching from the town of Aylesowen, through Lye, Cradley, Briley Hill, the Delph, Gornal, Amblecote, wonderful fire clay. Now you can understand this, I'm sure. It's never possible to contain molten metal or melt metal in metal vessels. The heat required to melt the content would, of course, first of all, melt the vessel. So fire clay or refractory is an essential thing. Now, having made iron, what happened? No canals, remember? No railways? So we began to process iron. What do I mean when I talk about processing iron? Well, near Wolverhampton is the town of Willenhall. For 400 years, I repeat that, for 400 years they've made locks and keys. And so it was. In a place called Netherton, the ocean-going liners and battleships wanted anchors. Come up to Nower Inchlade for great big anchors. Tubes, come into Wensbury. Springs, come into West Bromwich. Nuts and bolts, Darlaston. If you wanted forgings, heavy forgings, well, again, Willenhall, Warsaw for its foundries and other places, and many towns had a specialised trade. For example, Dudley made anvils and vices, Cradley Heath chain, Lye made nails. Every town, specialists, and therefore a tremendous worldwide reputation on the skills of the Black Country. But of course, ironwork, especially in the old days, could be tough. If ever you want to think about work, you ought to see the Schindlers. You ought to see men handling molten steel. You ought to see men making huge anchors, dive locks, especially when they used to have a great deal of hand strength. Have you ever heard that saying, black country born, black country bred, strong in the arm, weak in the head? Well, this was, of course, because of our heavy industry. Now, common in heavy industry, especially fire eaters, that's people who work with molten metal and on the fires, they always are able to drink a drop. So, in consequence, the people lived rather crude lives. They had a tendency to gamble a great deal. They loved their whippet. The whippet dog was often the most important member of the family. They used to feed the whippet with pork chops, eggs, sherry. Children had to make do with dip in the pan. They had their racing pigeons long before we had clocks and organized racing, the womers they called them. They were pigeons that would fly half a mile or a mile, but very fast, and could be watched home because there was no means of sending the pigeons away. Well, now, a lot of the social life depended, A, on the church, or the chapel, or the pub. And in all these, a lot of black country humour is quoted. Now, I think I ought to say this. Black country humour is always very clean. It can be repeated in mixed company and nobody will ever blush. And usually, the more important the man, more likely a good black country story with myself. Now, I am retired. I am named Wesley Perrins. Wesley. Ah, you've got it. I am a ranter. Well, now, many years ago, I was what they call in Methodist circles an exhorter. An exhorter was a young man training to get on preacher's plan. You had to study. But apart from the studying, as you grew up at about 17 or 18, they would send you round the circuit, always accompanying a very experienced local preacher. I wasn't 18, and I remember one night a very good Methodist in this area named Noah Jevons sent for me. "What is the matter, Mr. Jevons?" I said. "Wesley, I'm in a bit of a box." He meant he was in a difficulty. "Why?" "Well, by some accident," he said, "my name appears on the preacher's plan, on two preacher's plans for next Sunday. I can't be in two places." And he tried to persuade me to take one of the services. I demurred. I'd had no experience outside my own church. But he prevailed. "Oh, I wouldn't let you go, my boy, without I knew you could do it." So I went. First time on my own. Went very early. And there wasn't a soul at the chapel when I got there at 5:30 for a 6 o'clock service, but I did what Mr. Jevons said. I walked up the side of the chapel, I walked into a vestry. I didn't know it at the time, I was in the wrong vestry, but there was only a wood and glass partition. It seemed ages. And after a long time I heard a door open. Two men walked into the next vestry talking. One said to the other, "Zayo, Zayo, who is this young Perrins that Noah Jevons is sending to conduct the service tonight?" "Oh," he said, "I don't know, but he comes from the Lie. I suppose he's some relation of Amos's. They all knew my father. He was a well-known public man. Can he preach?" "Well, I've told you, Zayer, I don't know the lad." "Well, in that case," he says, "take my advice. Take up the collection before he starts." Now, that's a perfect true example. Now, just to show you, there's no respecter of persons we had in this town, a vicar. The only man in my own time who could keep the church not merely full, but over full. But our vicar had got a weakness. He liked to drop. But if I tell you that in 1885 we'd got 65 pubs for 6,000 people, you'll realise that folks here didn't mind the vicar having a drink. They never complained. If there was any criticism, they might say, "Oh, well, perhaps the vicar does dip his biscuit in a drop of whiskey." Well, now, my own sister Ruth was for many years, 28 years, a secretary in the sheet metal workers' office. They had a provident fund. If members were too ill to come to office for their benefit, my sister, out of the goodness of her heart, would pop round to the homes. She went to a home in Brook Street, Lye, and said to the woman at the house, "Well, how is Joe?" And Mrs. Pritchard, the woman at the house, said, "Oh, terrible, Ruth, terrible. The doctor's been twice and is coming again." So my sister knew the man was gravely ill. And the woman went on, Mrs. Pritchard went on, "He's told me, Ruth, I mustn't expect to have Joe tomorrow." So my sister said, "Well, now, have you sent for the vicar?" "Well, why should I, Ruth?" said Mrs. Pritchard. "He's only a lodger, been here 13 years, but I have never, ever known him go to church or chapel." But my sister said, "Ah, but Mrs. Pritchard, you know what you ought to do, and in the black country it is customary, whether they've been to church or chapel, to send for the parson when a man is obviously passing from this world to the next." So my sister said, "When I go back to the office, Mrs. Pritchard, I'll call and tell the vicar." So she did. She explained the man had never been known to go to church or chapel. But probably before my sister was back at the office, the vicar went to the house. Now the vicar did all those things a vicar does when a man is obviously leaving this world for the next. And when he'd finished, he said, "Now, Joe, could I do anything else? Could I write you some letters?" And he was this type of man. "No, vicar," he says, "I haven't got any friends or relatives. I've got nobody, vicar." "Now, are you quite sure, Joe?" Yes, he said, and then, as though it is an afterthought, Vicar, will you please read for me the 23rd Psalm? Certainly, said the vicar, he was delighted, and he read as only our vicar could read. You know the psalm, don't you? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me own. He was a beautiful reader. When he'd finished, Joe said, thank you kindly, vicar. Vicar, will you please read it again? Certainly, said the vicar gladly, and he read it a second time. And when he'd finished, Joe said, vicar, vicar, I know you're a busy man, but he said, will you please read it again? Certainly, said the vicar, but he thought he ought to make a few inquiries. Was this a special psalm? Did your mother teach it you? Learn it in some Sunday school, some day school? Oh, no, vicar, said Joe, no, vicar. It would not have mattered very much what you read, but your breath does smell lovely. Now, fairly recently, I went to a funeral of a man over 80. Blind, I'm sorry to say, at the end of his day. But, like myself, he'd been very active in church circles, and I remember when he, like I used to be, was an exhorter. And he came to my dad's chapel. Now, he was accompanying a man who came out to America as a pastor, Pastor Sam Powell. And he was a powerful preacher, was Sam Powell, but he used to bring my friend occasionally with him, help him on his way. Now, Sam Powell allowed my friend to read the lesson. It was the Easter lesson. You know it, don't you? And there was gross darkness on the face of the earth, taken from the crucifixion. And my friend paused. I wonder how many people in chapel tonight can understand those words that the writer put there, gross darkness on the face of the earth. Now, I can see you don't know, but remember this, my friends, that what the Bible says is true. Now, what it really means is that it was gross darkness. In other words, it was 144 times blacker than night. You can see, the church and the chapels can provide us with humour, but so does industry. Now, I personally knew a man here. Everybody knew him. A local character. His real name was Thomas Pardo. No one would have recognised him by his proper name, though. He was always known as Tommy Buffer. B-U-F-F-E-R. A man who can't tell the truth. And this signifies his character. Now, he got his livelihood by various means. He went round sales, buying things, but if ever the auctioneer saw Tommy Buffer turn up at a sale, he immediately detailed a porter off. Watch him. Keep your eye on Tommy, because if he bought an hearthrug, he would wrap up the fire irons. But that wasn't what I wanted to say. He went to a local anvil and vice manufacturer called Brooks's. He bought a load of scrap, took the horse and cart, loaded up the scrap. Shortly after he left the premises, they missed a brand new 500-weight anvil. They didn't bother much, they thought they knew. On the phone as quick as lightning, down to the police station, and when Tommy Buffer got back to his own premises with the horse and cart, there was a constable and a sergeant. The sergeant raised his hand and stopped the horse. They both looked into the cart. And as they expected, there was, in the scrap, a brand new 500-weight anvil. Would he like to make a statement? Would he? He merely raised his cloth cap as a token of esteem to the law. Gentlemen, he said to the sergeant and the constable, gentlemen, the only explanation I can offer is it must have gone in on the corner of the shovel. And it is said, of course, of the same man. I say he got his living all sorts of way, but you may not just understand this. But in this locality, we used to have what was called the blacking mill. They used to make a boot polish, heavy, tacky stuff, in a green pruce paper, mainly for miners or agricultural boots, very crude stuff. But he used to sell this, make it, and sell it on the marketplace. He went once to Dudley Market, had a very, very bad day. It was raining. Not many people came to the opening market. And as they were packing up market, one of the stallholders said, Tommy, you've got plenty of nerve. I know what that blacking is, you know, it's mutton fat. Got some dyeing for the polish and some turpentine. It won't hurt anybody. You take that blacking back, get your wife and daughter on, roll it into pills, run it in some starch or flour, and here's an address. You write to London. They'll send you a picture of the human skeleton and some patter, but it will cost you 5 shillings. But it'll be worth it. You'll earn it. So he wrote to London. He got the skeleton. He got the patter and learnt it off by heart. And then he got his wife and daughter rolling this blacking into pills. He went back the next week to Dudley, rang his bell, got a crowd round him, and began to explain the chart. What's this? Don't be afraid. This is a human body. What's this? These are the eyes, the mirror of the body. If you go to a doctor, the doctor looks at your eyes. He knows whether you are well. He'll tell you. What's this? The heart, the pump house. But what's this? The liver. Now, ladies, if your husband comes down out of sorts, what do you say? What do you say? He's out of sorts, isn't he? He's liverish. Now, you buy my pills, liver pills. If they don't do all I claim, bring back the box to prove you were a genuine purchaser, and next week I will give you a shilling for every sixpenny box of pills you bought. He had a record sale. Delighted, went back, got neighbours even, rolling more pills, reappeared in Dudley the following week, and went all through the patter about the eyes and the heart and liver, and he was about to make his sales. And a big burly collier from Gornal broke through the crowd. Are you the feller that was selling them pills last week? Yes, I was. Gaffer, he said, Gaffer, they're wonderful, they're marvellous. You give me 6 boxes, he said. You would not believe the black stuff they fetched off my stomach. Now, this, of course, is the sort of thing we pick up in many of our pubs. But, of course, council work, you know, the mayor and all those sort of people, well, they're always good, aren't they, for a joke. And with many stories, of course, about the mayor and the councillors. Indeed, we used to have a chap here known as Councillor Eli Omer. He was a dairyman. And I remember the occasion when they were having an extension to the cemetery, the burying ground. You see, here, church cemeteries have been full for a long time, so councils now usually run a crematorium and a burying ground. Well, normally in this locality, if an extension to a cemetery or a new cemetery is opened, have it consecrated, get the local clergy and laymen and have a service to consecrate it. And they were thinking of a consecration for the extension in the cemetery. And the chairman was explaining the needs for consecration. But poor Councillor Homer couldn't quite understand or grasp. And suddenly he said, look here, Mr. Chairman, I don't see any need to consecrate the whole of it. I don't mind you doing the paths. I did my backyard, and they wore like iron. Now, this year here, by the way, we are celebrating the centenary of what is known the Education Act of 1880. This is 1870, by the way, not 80, 1870. This is the start of what we call free education in this country. There was education before, mainly done by the churches. Well, now, here, we, prior to that time, people were poor, they did not go to school, they were completely illiterate, they didn't even go to church or chapel much those days, and here in Lye, people made nails, and in Albert Street, there were a pair of nailers. Now, the custom was this: if you had a baby, you wanted the baby christened or baptized, you didn't go to church and offer the baby for baptism as we do today, send out for the parson, let him come here, let him do the babby here, they used to say. And these nailers sent for the vicar. In due course the vicar came. They were at work in the nail shop attached to the house. They came out of the nail shop into the kitchen for the christening. Have you chosen a name? Said the vicar. but they were diffident, hesitant, tongue-tied, couldn't speak. He was used to these circumstances, so he said, well, shall I suggest a name? They were grateful, they nodded consent. Knowing the people were illiterate, he said, shall we have a very short name, an easy name, easy to say, easy to write? So they nodded consent, and the vicar suggested, why not call the child Ben, B-E-N, easy to say, easy to write, Ben. They nodded consent. He baptised the baby, he left. He had not gone 5 minutes before there was a physical fight between the man and his wife, and what they were fighting over, it was a girl. Now, we've still got descendants of that family, and we still call them the Bens here even now. Well, as I did say, a lot of our Black Country stuff is associated with people. Now, in this town of the Lie, small though it is, rough though it was, we've produced some famous men. Sir Cedric Hardwicke, the famous actor, whom Bernard Shaw said was amongst the three best male actors of the world. The man who became Secretary of State for Scotland, the Right Honourable Joseph Westwood, born here in Lie. And the man who's just recently retired as Bishop of Wales, Professor Edwin Morris, born in Lie. And indeed, Morris's father was a jeweller here. The shop still stands. Over the door of the shop is a clock. The jeweller's clock. The best clock in this locality. Everybody who passed the door automatically checked their time with Morris's clock. And every day, and I mean every day, a man called Green from Ludlow's works close by came across and pulled out his watch, checked his time with Morris's clock. So Mr. Morris Senior said to him one day, Green, you're always here, checking your watch with my clock. Why? Oh, said Mr. Green, look at the number of our employees from the works who pass this door. If I was 1 minute out, he said, they'd tell me. Oh, said Mr. Morris, that's all very well, Green. But, you know, I keep this clock right with your hooter. Now, when it comes to the pubs, of course, oh, there are legions of stories about the capacity of men to drink beer. And in one or two of our Black Country pubs, we've still got a yard of ale. This is a sort of a long trumpet type of bottle. It holds rather more than 2 quarts of beer, and the idea is to empty it in the shortest time. But part of the trick is how to balance this trumpet type of glass and not spill it. Well, I could tell you a lot about the capacity of men to drink, but here is one. I knew a man, a neighbour of mine, who was a big anvil maker, and they always could drink some beer. One night a crowd of men, in the air and hounds, arguing and talking about great feats of men who could drink. And suddenly, the striker, that's the helper of Bert Johnson, was prepared to bet any person that night in the air and hounds that his mate, Bert Johnson, would be able to pick up a 1 gallon can of beer, full of beer. Bert Johnson would put that can to his lips, and Bert would drink and drink and drink, without hindrance, let or pause, and empty the can. Well, of course, this brought forth a lot of comments. Some called him a glutton, but you know, there's still a certain amount of fame in that type of feat. But they missed Bert Johnson. And it may be half an hour, 3/4 hour after he came back. And he said to his mate, Sam, bet him £2, bet him £100, bet him my house. I know I can do it. I've been across to the vine and tried it. I told you earlier there are at least 28 towns in this Black Country. Now, while the habits of the people as to their capacity for drinking beer, for gambling, you know, their roughness, is the same, there is one difference, and that is this, the dialects. Now, a man taking part in this tape may be my very good friend, Alderman Clifford Willetts. He is a chainsmith. He has been for many, many years in public life. Indeed, he's a free man. Vale's Owen Borough. That's fame, isn't it? Well, now, Clifford Willett runs the ragged school in Two Gates. He has never, ever lived more than a mile from me. But you notice when he talks how different he is to me. Now, the ragged schools. We've still got two ragged schools. What are ragged schools, you may ask? Well, ragged schools, of course, had their foundation in Portsmouth, when a man called Pound, who was intended to be a shipwright, had an accident while he was yet a boy in the shipyard, and always had to walk with a lame foot. He had a clump foot. He had to learn a new trade. So he was apprenticed to shoemaking and boot repairing. And then when he was 52, he had a desire to help poor children in Portsmouth, for there were no schools at all. And he gathered about 40 children, took them into his workroom, and taught them to read and to write. This was a remarkable feat. And one day, after he had died, a famous minister in the Church of Scotland went to Portsmouth, went to the Unitarian Church. He was shown in the churchyard the grave of John Pound, and told the story of John Pound. And in consequence, he was so impressed, he went back home, wrote a famous pamphlet, a plea for ragged schools. And so in this country, they sprang up like violets in spring. All big towns had numbers of ragged schools that catered for very poor children. Now, I've got a book here, a pamphlet, printed 100 years ago in 1870, about Hightown Ragged School. The man who opened the ragged school was a Mr. Crowther. He started his meetings in an ordinary house. Talk about keeping pigeons in sheds in the gardens. They kept them in boxes in the kitchens, and the services were interfered with somewhat by the cooing of the pigeons, and you can imagine the smell. Well, now, well-meaning people like Sir Benjamin Ingelay and others found money, and they built a ragged school. But Crowder was the only man who could read. Bibles at that time were without point because he was the only reader. But he converted to the ragged school movement some of the worst characters in Cradley. Now, in Cradley, those days, they had the parade, or the walk. Now, the parade was the occasion in Fair Week when all the friendly societies like the Free Gardeners, the Art Fellows, the Arts of Oak paraded to advertise their society. Members put on shoulder ribbons with a big badge, had a banner, had a band, marched round the town to advertise themselves. And they always went into a pub, had a meal, and a lot of beer. So much so, a lot of people got drunk. Now, poor Mr. Crowther knew that if some of these new converts to the ragged school went on parade and they went into the pub and they had a lot to drink, they'd get drunk. And in consequence, just like the Salvation Army say, they'd be backsliders. And he was afraid. Afraid for his new converts. So his answer was to pray. And then, early in the morning, he sent the bellman round Cradley, crying a prayer meeting in the ragged school on parade day, and they assembled for prayer. Now, friends, I've read of some strange prayers. Some of you may know that Jonah prayed, or is reputed to have prayed, out of the belly of the big fish, but, friends, I have never, ever read of a prayer quite like this one in the ragged school, where one of these roughest of characters, an old prize fighter, stood up, and the burden of his prayer was that the Lord would tell him when he'd had enough to drink on the Friendly Society parade. And the Lord told him, and he came out of the parade, and he brought companions, and they set up a rival procession and walked round, and you know words, but somebody hastily composed a bit of doggerel. They knew no tune, so they sang it to the only tune they knew, God Save the Queen, and it went, God bless our ragged school, may it thrive and rule, and so on. So you can see there is a wonderful story. In the same way, we have just one side, Dudley, a place that used to be called Sodom, Now, don't ask me why. You must assume you know why it was called Sodom. But in Sodom, they had a Methodist chapel. Sodom Methodist Chapel. It was a primitive Methodist. And in the early days, they often went on what they called camp meetings, open-air work. Now, they did convert to this particular cause a man called Thomas Nichols, a steel worker, a prize fighter, heavy drunkard. And he went on open-air work with his band of primitive Methodists. But when some of his mates knew they were going on open-air work, they would go and try to upset the open-air meetings, jeer and sneer. One day, Tom Nichols, who had been a prize fighter, could stand it no longer. He stripped off his coat. "I've resigned," he said, "from being a primitive Methodist." And he set about his chief tormentor, gave him a terrible hiding there and then, put on his coat again, and said, "I'm a Methodist again now." But there was never, ever any more interference with the camp meetings. Well, now, this kind of story, of course, repeats itself right throughout the whole of the industrial black country. Our people were warm, very warm. Now, I wonder if I could tell you, I mentioned, didn't I, about famous men, I mentioned Sir Cedric Hardwick. Well, of course, nearby in Aylesowen, we'd got Brett Young, and in Warsaw, I'd got Jerome K. Jerome. Oh, there's plenty of famous men. But Sir Cedric's father was a doctor, a local doctor. Now, here in Lye, we still have a fairly important firm, old established firm, enameled alloyware, galvanized alloyware, called Everson's. And Mr. David Everson worked in the factory making trunks, tin trunks. Now, in the old days, they used black plate, sheet plate, and hammering it brought, of course, a lot of dust, the rust, etc., off the plate into the men's nostrils. So practically every black plate worker in the old days took snuff, except in David Everson. David was always a bit odd. He was a vegetarian. So when they did their steak for their midday meal in the stall, David contented himself with a few nuts and orange. But he was educated. He could argue, he could talk, and all sorts of topics were discussed while the men were having their midday meal. One day, the conversation turned to taking snuff. David Everson said it was a filthy habit. Of course it was, but that didn't bother the men much. He went on to say, taking snuff affects the brains. Now, this is one thing you daredn't say to a black country man, that anything can affect his brains. But nevertheless, one of these men, a chap called Owen Knowles, a little later was ill. He had the flu. He was in bed. And it was pretty obvious that David Everson's comment about taking snuff affecting the brain concerned him, because he did take snuff. So when Dr. Hardwick called at the house in the course of duty, Owen Knowles spoke to the doctor. "Doctor, doctor, is it right what David Everson says, that taking snuff affects the brain?" "Don't be ridiculous," said the doctor. "Of course it doesn't." "Well, doctor, can you give me something to tell David Everson?" "Well, tell him the doctor says." "Oh," he says, "no use telling David Everson that. He can talk the leg off an iron pot. He'll want more reason than that, doctor. Can't you tell me something else?" The doctor thought for a moment, and then he said, "Well, you tell David Everson, Dr. Hardwick says that taking of snuff does not affect the brains. And if he says why, you tell him that folks with brains don't take snuff." Three small places joined together to form the Lye, and it was always called the, T-H-E, the Lye. They always said of us, the Lye, the Waste, Careless Green, the three worst places ever seen, and that, of course, is generally true of the habits of the people over a wide area. Well, now, I did mention, didn't I, the impact of the army. In the poorer quarters and the rougher, the poorer the quarter, the truer it is. We owed a great deal to the Salvation Army. I remember about 40 years ago going to the Citadel at Lye, only to preside at a band concert, because I'm a Methodist, but I went to preside at their band concert. But the star attraction was the man who opened a corps here in 1885. And if you could have heard that man talking about what Lye was like in 1885, your hair would stand on end. They talk about mods and rockers and Hell's Angels and the like. They had got nothing on the young men of Lye. They broke the windows, broke the furniture, tore the Bibles, broke his heart. And the officer prayed about it. And then he got the young men, the young hooligans, to assemble outside the citadel, bring a beanstick, a mopstick, a broomstick. And so he marched them as you might march a band of soldiers from Lye, Stourbridge Town Clock, out to Hagley Cattle Market, up to Wales Owen Church, round Blackheath, 15 miles on the route march. And when they were tired, well, he could talk. And that man was publicly thanked by the police for his good work here in Lye. And this, of course, is the background of the old area, if you come. No smoke now. See, it was a black country because we burnt coal in the raw. And only 1930, and even later, I could stand at eye point and I could have challenged you. I will give you £100 if you can count for me the stacks that emitted heavy black smoke. But today we've got extractors, as you know, in the chimneys. Today we have gas and electricity for heat, and the air is clean and pure. And out have gone the old dirty places, and in have come new modern estates, sometimes tall flats. We've got colleges of further education. You know, this is a change, because they always said, oh, a man doesn't want educating to work. But today they want diplomas and all manner of things to hold down a job because of the tremendous changes that we've seen in mechanized industry. Well, we are respectable now. We take our place in the community, and nobody hardly knows that we're any different. And yet, a few years ago, around about 1930, I attended a celebration to mark the retirement of a man who for 50 years had been a collector of rights in this territory. And after the ceremony, I knew the man well. I said, oh, Mr. Thompson, what would you say is the biggest change you've seen in this area since you started first 50 years ago in the water rate office for rate collecting? He paused for a time. He thought, and then this is what he said. I would think it is the fact that working men now wear collars. We are wearing collars, you know, now, and we do look respectable. A lot of people are now trying to talk not my language, but the Queen's English. If at any time ever you come into this black country, if you care to call on me at 19 Walker Avenue, Wollescote, I'll be happy to give you the background. My own area, and we've all got our own story. Good morning. I hope you've enjoyed the talk.